Hey, praise the Lord. It's me, Brother Clinton, once again. Welcome to my office. It is the seventh day of the week, the first day of April, the year of our Lord, 2017, 5777. And God willing, I'd like to continue with you right now in the eighth chapter of 1 Corinthians in this series that we've been doing, starting with the first chapter and going through 1 Corinthians verse by verse. So if you're just coming into this series right now, I highly recommend that you go back to the beginning of this playlist and start at the beginning of 1 Corinthians. I think you'll find it a blessing. And for those of you who have been with me all this time, let's begin in the eighth chapter of 1 Corinthians, and may God bless the reading of his word. Blessed be the name of the Lord. So we know that this letter is a letter that was written by Paul, the apostle of Jesus Christ, to the church at Corinth. We know that it's one of at least two letters, probably three or more, that Paul wrote to the church at Corinth after he had spent 18 months with them, teaching them, having preached the gospel to them and baptizing them in Jesus' name and laying hands on them. They received the Holy Ghost. And Jesus did say to Paul that he had many people in that city. And so Paul stayed there for a long time. He stayed there for a year and a half. And then he left. And after he left, they wrote to him letters with questions. And he's writing back. In this letter in 2 Corinthians also, to address their questions and concerns, to teach them doctrine, to reprove and rebuke them on some things, to praise them on some things, and for many other such like purposes. And so, pardon me, having gone through chapter 7, Paul explained many things about the doctrine of marriage and what God would have his people in the churches to know about marriage, about divorce, about adultery, about fornication, about many things that are having to do with the covenant of marriage. About eunuchs and those who are made eunuchs for the kingdom of God, and explain the difference between a virgin and a married woman, and between a young man who is a virgin and a married man. And so, having gone through all that, it just kind of stops there at 1 Corinthians 7:40 at the end of that chapter, and Paul just kind of very abruptly changes the subject, okay, because he has explained what he needed to explain. And so in chapter 8, verse 1, and this is a relatively short chapter, so this probably won't take very long, but we never know. Let's see what happens when we get to the end of this video. He says, "Now as touching things offered unto idols, we know that we all have knowledge. Knowledge puffeth up, but charity edifieth." Okay. This is what the next three chapters are all about. This verse of the scripture, this one verse, these two sentences, are telling us what the next three chapters of this letter are all about. As we read through the next three chapters, it goes all back to this one sentence right here, or these two sentences right here. "Now, as touching things offered unto idols, we know that we all have knowledge. Knowledge puffeth up, but charity edifieth." Okay, when he says we know that we all have knowledge, he's of course speaking to the church of Jesus Christ, because that's who this letter is addressed to. Now, let me just take a moment here and say that if you're not part of the Church of Jesus Christ, then you're welcome to and encouraged to hear this message and to read the scripture, but you have to understand that this letter isn't addressed to you until you are baptized in Jesus' name, filled with the Holy Ghost, having turned from your sins and walking with the Lord Jesus Christ. And when that has happened, when you've obeyed the gospel of Jesus Christ and you're walking with him, then this letter is addressed to you. Okay. If that hasn't happened yet, then you can learn an awful lot from reading this letter, but you have to understand that this letter wasn't addressed to you if you're not in the Church of Jesus Christ. Having said that, he says, "Now as touching things offered unto idols, we know that we all have knowledge." Okay, we know, those of us in the Church of Jesus Christ, we know that an idol is nothing. Okay, the Catholic statues, for example, that they call Jude and Mary and Paul are no more important to God than this pen. Okay, if a piece of meat was, you know, if some guy in the desert somewhere sacrificed a piece of meat to this pen, I'm not going to have any problem eating that piece of meat, because I know that this pen is nothing. It's just a pen. It doesn't have any power to affect that piece of meat in any way, shape, or form. But that knowledge, even though it is common, is something that we should use wisely. Okay, knowledge and wisdom are two different things. Knowledge is knowing something, and wisdom is how you apply that knowledge. Let me say that again. Knowledge is knowing something. That's why it's called knowledge. It's a form of the word know. To have knowledge is to know something. To have wisdom is to understand how to use that knowledge, how to apply that knowledge. So knowledge and wisdom are two different things that go hand in hand. You see. So he says, "Now as touching things offered unto idols, we know that we all have knowledge." Okay, all of us in the Church of Jesus Christ, we know that an idol is nothing. It doesn't have any power. It doesn't have, if meat is sacrificed unto that piece of plastic or wood or stone or whatever, that doesn't change the condition of that meat at all. The meat is still meat, and it makes no difference whether it was sacrificed unto an inanimate object. We all know this. We all know this, okay? So let's just start with that platform. We all know this, okay? Now, he says, knowledge puffeth up, but charity edifieth. Now, this is where Paul begins to say the same things that we went over in the 14th chapter of the book of Romans when we went through the Romans series. For those of you who don't know, there's a playlist on this channel called the Book of Romans, verse by verse. And we went through the whole book of Romans. And in the 14th chapter of Romans, Paul, the same apostle Paul who wrote this letter, was teaching the people in Rome, the church in Rome, about meats sacrificed unto idols. No, excuse me. Yes, about meats sacrificed unto idols and about Sabbath days. Okay? And he was talking about abstaining from meats, rather, and Sabbath days. And he explained that even though some of us might know these things, we have to use wisdom in the ways that we apply this knowledge so as not to offend a brother. And when I say offend, I don't say that in so much the sense of causing someone's feelings to be hurt, but in the other sense of the word, the English word offend, which means to cause somebody to stumble. Okay? The word offend in English means to cause somebody to stumble and fall down. That's what the word offend means. In addition to having the meaning of hurting someone's feelings. That's also a meaning of the word offend. So he says, knowledge puffeth up, but charity edifieth. Okay, the fact that you and I all know that an idol has no power to change the quality of any meat, okay, to change the nature of any meat or of anything, the fact that we know that is good and right, but the way that we apply this knowledge is going to affect the lives of other people. And as if we are Christians and we bear the name of Jesus Christ in us, then we have to be very careful about how we conduct ourselves in front of other people, especially in front of other brethren, because we are going to stand before the Lord Jesus Christ and give account. All right, we are not among those people who believe that we're Christians just because we said a sinner's prayer and now we believe that we're saved, and once we're saved we can never be unsaved. Okay, we're Christians. We don't believe that nonsense and gobbledygook. That's for the denominations that don't know the Lord Jesus Christ. We have been saved from our sins by the grace of God through faith, by obeying the gospel, by being baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, having turned from our sins, being baptized in Jesus' name and filled with the power of His Spirit. And we speak with other tongues and prophesy by the power of His Spirit. You see, so we're sealed unto the day of redemption. And we work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. We've been saved from the power of darkness, and if we continue in that salvation, then we will be saved in the day of wrath, when the wrath of our God comes upon the ungodly of this world. You see? So we work out our own salvation in fear and trembling. See, we walk through this pilgrimage on this earth in fear. You see? Fearing the Lord our God. And that's what Peter said as well. And so he says, knowledge puffeth up, but charity edifieth. Okay, charity is a word, an English word that means love. But it doesn't mean a feeling of love, it means the action of love. Charity means love in action. Charity means when you love someone by doing things that love would do. That's what charity means. That's why organizations that collect money to give to poor people are called charities. Okay, and I know that most of them are not honest. We're not going to go there. That has nothing to do with the subject at hand. But the reason that they're called charities is to give the impression that they are doing something out of love for those who are needy. That's what the word charity means, to do something for someone out of love when they have need of it. See? And so knowledge puffeth up, but charity edifieth. Okay, you can say, I know this and I know that all day long. But until you act on it and do something about it, then it's worth nothing. It puffs you up like a Cheeto. Okay, what happens when you put a Cheeto in your mouth? After about 1 second, it dissolves into nothing. Right? So you're like a Cheeto if you're just knowledge. See, if you don't have charity. And Paul spoke about that also in the 13th chapter of this letter, which we'll get into at another time when we get to that part. But knowledge puffeth up, but charity edifieth. Okay, it doesn't matter what you know, it matters what you do. Okay, as I've said many times before, and I borrowed this from someone else, nobody's going to care how much you know until they know how much you care. It's just that simple. So knowledge puffeth up, but charity edifieth. And then he goes on to say, and if any man think that he knoweth anything, He knoweth nothing yet as he ought to know. Okay? So if you and I get to the point where we think we don't have anything to learn anymore, we think we've got it all under control, we think we know it all, we're in big trouble because we know nothing as we ought to know. You know, does God really have to come to us and do like he did to Job and ask, you know, questions that no man has any answer to in order to humble us and cause us to understand that we are as a grain of sand in his sight? Who are we to walk around all puffed up thinking that, you know, our knowledge makes us better than any man or makes us commendable to God? It certainly does not. The only thing that makes us commendable to God is the blood of his son, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah to his name. And so if any man think that he knoweth anything, he knoweth nothing yet as he ought to know. Now what's Paul getting at? Well, we know that an idol is nothing in this world. We know this. But how do we apply that knowledge? This is what Paul wants to talk to us about. He says, but if any man love God, the same is known of him. If any man love God, the same is known of him. If you love God, then God will know you. God knows you. If you love God, if you love God, and what did God say when he was in the flesh? If you love me, keep my commandments. If you love me, keep my commandments. He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. Okay? Not he that hath my commandments and can recite them. He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. And so he says, but if any man love God, the same is known of him. You see, what did Jesus say? And I and my Father will come to him and make our abode with him. Blessed be the name of the Lord. So verse 4, as concerning therefore the eating of those things that are offered in sacrifice unto idols, we know that an idol is nothing in the world, and that there is none other God but one. Okay, we know this. This is basic knowledge. It's like we know the difference between our right shoe and our left shoe. Hopefully. Okay, that's basic knowledge. It's not something you have to go to college for. You know, you just kind of figure it out when you're like 3 years old. It's basic knowledge. For though there be that are called gods, whether in heaven or in earth, as there be gods many and lords many, okay, there's lots of things in this world that by the mouths of men are called gods. Okay, for though there be that are called gods, whether in heaven or in earth, as there be gods many and lords many. But to us, the church of Jesus Christ, but to us, there is but one God, the Father. But to us, there is but one God, the Father. That is the only God there is. The only God that exists is the Father. And Jesus Christ said this in John 17:3, when he said, and this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent. The only true God. See, and this is what Paul is saying here as well, in verse 6. But to us there is but one God, the Father, of whom are all things. And I'm going to spend a couple minutes on this verse because I know that some of you are going to have some questions about it. So rather than writing me questions about it, I'm just going to address these things right now so you won't have to. But to us there is but one God, the Father, of whom are all things, and we in him. Okay? Semicolon. There is one God, the Father. That's the only God there is. There is no God the Son. There is no God the Holy Spirit. For those of you who still believe in a Trinity, and I'm going to declare to you right now that there is no such thing, as I declare all the time, because there is no such thing. There is no Trinity. There is no triune God. There is no God the Son. There is no God the Holy Spirit. There is only God the Father. He is the only God there is. I believe in the Son of God. I do not believe in God the Son, because I'm a Christian, not a Catholic. You see? Let me say that again. I believe in the Son of God. I do not believe in God the Son, because I am a Christian. I am not a Catholic. God the Son doesn't exist. There is no God the Son. There is no such deity in existence anywhere. There has never been, ever, and there shall never be. The Son of God is the Son of God. He is a man who was begotten in the womb of a woman whose father was God and whose mother was a woman. This is why he's called the Son of God and the Son of Man. Man being a generic term which means humankind, because his mother was a woman, you see? So the Son of God is the Son of God. Now, Brother Clinton, you're denying the deity of Jesus Christ. You're saying he was just a man. No, I'm not saying he was just a man. I've never said that he was just a man. But the Bible does say that there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. The man Christ Jesus. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, is a man. He is not a deity. He is a man. But at the same time, I'm not saying that he's just a man, although many of you out there will imagine that I've said that. I've never said that. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, is a man, and in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. What is the Godhead? It is a singular noun that means the deity. And who is the deity? God the Father. God the Father is the Godhead. It's just that simple. But to us there is but one God, the Father, of whom are all things. God created all things by himself. There was no one with God in the beginning. No one helped God create anything. God did not have a mediator when he created anything. He did not create anything through anyone else. And if your Bible says that all things were created through Jesus Christ, your Bible is not the Word of God, because the Word of God doesn't say that. And we're going to talk about that in a moment as well. It's in the last part of this verse. But to us there is but one God, the Father. Now, this is just as basic as we know that we all have knowledge concerning idols. We know that an idol is nothing in the world. Okay, that's basic knowledge. So is this. There is but one God, the Father. There is no other God except the Father. He's called the Father because he has a Son. Of whom are all things. He created all things. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Okay, Isaiah 44:24 tells us that God stretched forth the heavens by himself and created all things by himself. Okay, in fact, let me read that for you. It's Isaiah chapter 44, verse 24. And it says, thus saith the Lord, thy Redeemer, and he that formed thee from the womb, I am the Lord that maketh all things, that stretcheth forth the heavens alone, that spreadeth abroad the earth by myself. God created all things by himself. And this is why 1 Corinthians 8:6 says, but to us there is but one God, the Father, of whom are all things. There is nothing that exists that God did not create. That's why in John chapter 1 it says, by him all things were made, and nothing is made. Without him nothing is made that was made. Okay, who is the him referring to? God. The Almighty God, of course. He's the one that made all things. Okay, and then it says, and we in him. 1 Corinthians 8:6, and we in him. Okay, we are, those of us who are in Jesus Christ, we are in God the Father. How? Because we are in his Son, Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ, his Son, is in him. You see? If Jesus Christ, his Son, is in him, and we are in his Son, Jesus Christ, then we are in God the Father. It's just that simple. Okay? If you get inside your car, and then you drive your car into the garage, then you are in the garage. How are you in the garage? You're inside your car, which is inside the garage. Okay? Now, that's an earthly example, and I didn't need to do that, but I did anyway. But we are in him. We are in him by Jesus Christ. And let me give you more scripture to show you that. Let's go to 1 John. And I believe it's the last verse, or the second to the last verse. Second to the last verse. It says, and 1 John 5:20, it says, and we know that the Son of God has come and hath given us an understanding that we may know him that is true. And we are in him that is true, even in his Son, Jesus Christ. This is the true God and eternal life. See, we are in him by being in his Son, Jesus Christ. This is the true God and eternal life. And then it says, little children, keep yourselves from idols, which is what we're talking about here in 1 Corinthians chapter 8. Praise the Lord. So, but to us there is but one God, the Father, of whom are all things, and we in him. We understand what this means up until this point, up until the semicolon. Okay. Now, let's continue and talk about the Son of God. And one Lord, Jesus Christ. Okay, one Lord Jesus Christ. This is not talking about another person of a Godhead, because there are no persons in the Godhead. It's talking about the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the man Christ Jesus, the man who was begotten as a baby in the womb of a woman whose father was God and whose mother was a woman, the Lord of all, the Son of God, the King of kings, the Lord of lords, the bright and morning star. Hallelujah, the first and the last. the Almighty who has come in the flesh, and his name is Jesus Christ, which proclaims that he is the one which is and which was and which is to come, the Almighty which has come in the flesh to save us. That's what Jesus Christ means. And so this is talking about the Son of God, by whom the Almighty God was manifest in the flesh. And one Lord Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, and we by him. Okay, now look at the way the words are set. Now look at the way this is worded. Look at the way these words are placed. It's on purpose. Okay, but to us there is but one God, the Father, of whom are all things, and we in him. And one Lord Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, and we by him. Okay, so what is it? What's the difference between of whom and by whom? Okay, of whom are all things means that he's the one who created everything. Everything that exists owes its existence to him because he created all things. But by whom are all things means something a little different. Let's go to Ephesians for a moment. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 9. This is, I think, that I know of, it's the only other time in the Bible that uses these exact words. But Ephesians chapter 3, verse 9 says, and this part of the verse is omitted in pretty much every New Age Bible that I've ever seen. It's the last part of verse 9. Paul said, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ. Now, if your Bible says, who created all things through Jesus Christ, then your Bible is not the Word of God. Okay, in English, the Word of God is the King James Version of the Holy Bible. If your Bible is worded differently than the King James Version, and it's in English, then it's not the Word of God. It's been changed. And so I highly suggest that you go out and find yourself a King James Version of the Bible. And if you don't have one in your house, a paper copy, you can read it online until you find one. I highly recommend Bible Gateway, although I don't get paid to say that. I don't know if they... I don't know what I was about to say. That's not an endorsement. It's just my personal opinion. I enjoy Bible Gateway. But there's lots of sites out there that have the Bible online. Having said that, who created all things by Jesus Christ? Okay, this doesn't say through Jesus Christ. God did not create anything through anyone. He created all things by himself. So why does the Bible say by Jesus Christ? Who created all things by Jesus Christ? It says the same thing in 1 Corinthians 8:6. Because God, when he created all things, created all things with one thing in the center. In his mind or in his heart, before he created anything, it was all done. Because remember, the Bible says, in the beginning was the Word. In the beginning was the Word. You see, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. Okay, there was no one in the beginning with God. There was no person in the beginning with God. There was no other entity in the beginning with God. But the Word of God was in the beginning with God. And the Word was done before it started. You see, before God said, let there be light, the last chapter of the book of Revelation was already done. It only had to be written down by the hand of his prophets in the process of time, in the unfolding of time. But it was already done. You see, God did not create the heavens and the earth and then just try to figure it out as he went along. He created the heavens and the earth with the perfect knowledge of what he was going to do by coming in the flesh 4,000 years later. That was the beginning of the plan. You see, this is why the scripture says in Revelation chapter 13, verse 8, that the Lamb was slain before the foundation of the world. The Lamb of God was slain before the foundation of the world. But wait a minute, the Lamb of God was slain 2,000 years ago. So was the Lamb of God slain twice? No. Of course not, but it was done before it started. God is the one who calls the end from the beginning. You see, he didn't just start out on this journey and then, you know, do his best to try to all make it come to pass according to his will. It was all done before it started. It's fixed, boys and girls. It's fixed. You know, those of you who are sports fans, really are probably not going to be watching this video because this video is for Christians, but... If you know anything about sports, and maybe you used to be a sports fan before you got saved, praise the Lord, you know that being fixed means that it was rigged. That before it even started, they knew who was going to win. Okay, well, that's how God has done it. Okay, and that's his prerogative to do so. It's not cheating. It's in fact wisdom. Okay, so it's fixed. God knew the end from the beginning, and he called the end from the beginning. And before God said, "Let there be light," he had already been crucified for the sins of the world. God and his son, Jesus Christ. It was already done. You see, the Lamb of God was already slain before God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. Before God began to create anything, the Lamb of God, which was slain for the sins of the world, was already slain. It's just that it hadn't come to pass yet in a natural sense in the unfolding of time until time unfolded and it came to pass. You see, and that's why the scripture says that the Son of God was foreordained before the foundation of the world. Pay attention now. Are you paying attention? The Son of God, the Bible says that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, in 1 Peter 1:20, it says that he was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you. And this is why Jesus said, "Glorify thou me, O Father, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was." You see, many people stumble at that, John 17:5, and they think that Jesus Christ was saying, the Son of God was saying that he was there with his Father before the world was, but he didn't say that. He didn't say that he was there with his Father before the world was. He said he had glory with his Father before the world was. And there's a difference, because he was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you. And so were you and I, if you're a Christian. We were predestinated before the foundation of the world to be adopted into the family of God by the Son of God, Jesus Christ. You see, I had glory with my Father before the foundation of the world. So did you if you're a Christian. Praise the Lord. He said to Jeremiah, "Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee." How can you know someone that doesn't exist yet? If you're God, and you've already ordained for that person to exist, and there's nothing that can stop that person from existing because you have ordained it, and so in process of time it's going to come to pass, and there's no ifs or buts about it, then you can say, "I knew you before I formed you in the womb, before I formed you in the belly." You see, and you and I, according to Ephesians, the book of Ephesians, let's just read that, the first chapter of Ephesians, real quick. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 4 and 5, it says, "According as he hath chosen us in him," he in him, God in his Son Jesus Christ, "according as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him, in love having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will." You see? So you and I were predestined before the foundation of the world, but we didn't exist before the foundation of the world. But God knew before the foundation of the world that you and I would exist, because he ordained it to be so. And so it is with his Son, Jesus Christ. You and I had glory with the Father before the foundation of the world. I speak to those who are my brethren. And our King, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, had glory with our Father and his Father before the foundation of the world. He was crucified before the foundation of the world. But did he exist before the foundation of the world? No, he did not. He didn't exist until he was formed in his mother's womb. Neither did you and I. So God knew us before the foundation of the world, but we didn't exist until we were conceived in our mother's womb. Why? This is because God created all things by Jesus Christ. God, knowing that he was going to come in the flesh and purposing that he was going to come in the flesh to save sinners, even though there weren't any sinners yet, because God hadn't created anything yet, but according to his great love, he ordained that knowing that there would be sin, he would be the Savior, and he would come in the process of time in the flesh by begetting a son and inhabiting that son and living and walking in him and manifesting himself to his people Israel and to the world. That was the center of God's plan. And before God created anything, the whole plan was already done. And the whole plan centers around one man. And that man is the Son of God, Jesus Christ. And so by Jesus Christ, God created all things. By Jesus Christ, God created all things. Not through Jesus Christ, as if he created all things through a mediator. That's ridiculous. And the Bible doesn't say anything like that. God created all things by Jesus Christ. And we are by him. We are in God by him. Just like the little parable that the earthly parable that I put for you, put forth to you about being in the car, being in the garage by being in the car. Okay? If you're in the car and you're in the garage, you're in the garage. by the car, by means of the car. You see? And if you're a Christian, then you're in God the Father. You're in Him. You see? How are you in Him? By Jesus Christ, His Son. By being in Jesus Christ, His Son. Because Jesus Christ said, I am the way and the truth and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Not but through me. Again, if your Bible says but through me, then your Bible's not the Word of God. Because the word through is not in John 14:6. The word through is not in John 14:6. John 14:6 says, I am the way and the truth and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. You see? If you're in Jesus Christ, then you're in the Father because Jesus Christ is in the Father. See, He is the Son of God. He is a man. And He overcame sin by His own merit and virtue because He's the Son of God. And He came by water and blood, which was what the scripture says in 1 John. He came by water and blood, not by water only, but by water and blood. You see, and it is the Spirit that beareth witness because the Spirit is truth. So this is He that came by water and blood in order to bring us unto the place where He was, which was where? In the Father. In the Father. When He was baptized in the Jordan River, He was baptized into His Father, and His Father put His Spirit upon Him, and so His Father was in Him. So that's why Jesus said, Christ said, I am in my Father, and the Father in me. You see? And then in John chapter 14, He said something very profound, and I want to read that for you. John chapter 14. I don't remember the exact verse, so give me just a moment. It's in verse 20. He says, at that day ye shall know that I am in my Father, and ye in me, and I in you. This is our relationship with the Almighty God, brothers and sisters. Those of you who are my brothers and sisters. At that day, He says, ye shall know that, what day? This day, right now. At that day, ye shall know that I am in my Father, and ye in me, and I in you. How did Jesus Christ, the Son of God, come to be in His Father? When He was baptized in the Jordan River. He didn't have any sin. He wasn't being baptized for the remission of his sins. He was being baptized so that He could be in the Father. And what happened when He was baptized? The heavens opened up and God the Father testified, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. So Jesus Christ, the Son of God, came to be in the Father. And then God the Father put His Spirit upon Him, okay? Not God the Holy Spirit. There is no such person as God the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is God the Father. And He put His Spirit in Him. Well, why do I say the Holy Spirit is God the Father? Because when God the Father put His Spirit upon Jesus Christ, then after that, Jesus Christ said, my Father is in me. You see? There wasn't two gods inside of Jesus Christ, God the Father and God the Holy Spirit. There was only one God inside of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. In Him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, God the Father. You see? And so He says, at that day ye shall know that I am in my Father, and ye in me. Okay, how do we become in Jesus Christ? The same way that Jesus Christ came to be in His Father, through baptism. We are baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Why? So that we can be baptized into Jesus Christ. See, so we're in Jesus Christ, the Son of God, baptized into His name, and He is in His Father, and so we in turn are in His Father because we are in Him. And then He says, and I in you, and I in you. The Spirit of Christ. Christ in you, the hope of glory, the Holy Ghost, God the Father. That same Spirit of God that dwelt in Jesus Christ, who was speaking these words that John wrote down, and I in you. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Let's go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 8. Now let's read verse 6 again with the understanding. But to us there is but one God. Remember, he's talking about the fact that we know that idols are nothing. We know that there are many things in the world that are called gods. Okay, but just because something is called a god doesn't mean that it is God. He says, but to us there is but one God, the Father. That's the only God there is, the Father. Of whom are all things, and we in Him. Okay, we understand that now. And one Lord Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, and we by Him. Does this make sense now? Praise the Lord. Praise God. If it does, it's because you have received this revelation from the Father, because flesh and blood cannot reveal it unto thee. I can explain it to thee, but only God can reveal it unto thee. My brother, my sister, praise the Lord. Verse 7, howbeit there is not in every man that knowledge. Okay, there is not in every man that knowledge. For some, with conscience of the idol unto this hour, eat it as a thing offered unto an idol, and their conscience being weak is defiled. Okay, now what is Paul talking about? Is he saying that there is some in the church that don't have the knowledge of God? No, I don't believe that to be the case. But there are some that are recently baptized, or there are some that are weak in the faith, as he said in chapter 14 of Romans. Those that are weak in the faith, receive ye, but not to doubtful disputations. Okay. Now he said, howbeit there is not in every man that knowledge. With the words that knowledge, he wasn't talking about the knowledge of the fact that there is one God and one Lord Jesus Christ. He was talking about the fact that the knowledge that there is nothing that an idol has power to do. An idol has power to do nothing. It is plastic or wood or whatever finite material it is made out of. Okay, it can't walk. It has to be carried because there's no life in it. That's what he was talking about. Howbeit there is not in every man that knowledge. Okay, because there were some in the church that had been raised up in that idolatry, and they were raised up in it their whole lives, and they had been converted unto Jesus Christ. They believed that Jesus Christ is the Lord, the Son of God, and they were baptized in his name, and they received of his Spirit. But they were still a little bit uneasy about eating things sacrificed unto idols. Even though we know that an idol is nothing in the world and that it has no power to change the nature of a piece of meat, still there are those that don't have that knowledge. Just like there are those in the church who, you know, were once Jews, ceremonial Jews, you know, Orthodox Jews, and they believe that they should keep the Sabbath day. Okay, well, there's no such commandment for us in the church to keep Sabbath days. But at the same time, if you are used to the Jewish tradition and your conscience won't allow you to forego the keeping of Sabbath days at this point, then keep Sabbath days. And God forbid that I should dissuade you from doing so and wound your weak conscience. Because if you forbear keeping the Sabbath day when you believe in your heart that you should keep the Sabbath day, then you are sinning against the Lord. Because whatsoever is not of faith is sin. You see? And if I, knowing that an idol is nothing, and that it doesn't have any power to change the nature of a piece of meat, teach you to eat meat sacrificed unto idols when you have not come to the point where your conscience is comfortable with that, because you were raised believing that meat sacrificed to idols has been changed somehow or been consecrated to that idol, then I am causing you to sin against God. If I embolden you to do that which you don't think in your heart that you should do, because whatsoever is not of faith is sin. All right? Well, let's continue in verse 7 again. Let's start verse 7 over. Howbeit, there is not in every man that knowledge, for some with conscience of the idol unto this hour eat it as a thing offered unto an idol, and their conscience being weak is defiled. Okay, now that's what I just explained to you. Their conscience being weak is defiled, all right? They're eating something that they don't really think that they should be eating just because you're telling them that it's okay to do so. And of a truth, the meat that they're eating can't defile them. And Jesus said that. It's not what goes into your mouth that defiles you. It's what comes out of the mouth of a man that defiles him. Nothing going into your mouth can defile you, for it goes into your belly and comes out in the draft. So, but if someone has a weak conscience and they feel that this is sinful to do so, then to them it is sin, because whatsoever is not of faith is sin. He that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. You see, if you believe that something is sinful, even if it might not be against God's law to do so, if you believe it's against God's law to do so and you do it anyway, then you're sinning, because you're purposely doing something that you believe is wrong. Whether or not it's wrong at all, whether or not God has ever condemned that particular act, makes no difference to the fact that you, if you're doing it and you believe that it's wrong, then you're purposely doing something that you believe is wrong, and that's a sin. You see? Let's go on, verse 8. But meat commendeth us not to God. For neither if we eat are we the better, neither if we eat not are we the worse. Right? Eating or not eating meat has nothing to do with our right standing with God. It has nothing to do with it. If we eat meat every day or if we never eat meat again, God doesn't care. It doesn't make any difference to our relationship with God. It doesn't commend us to the righteousness of God. Neither eating meat or abstaining from meat commends us to the righteousness of God. God doesn't care about eating meats, because the kingdom of God is not in meat and drink, but in righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. Verse 9, but take heed lest by any means this liberty of yours become a stumbling block to them that are weak. Okay? Now, Paul said, hast thou faith? Have it to thyself. Okay? If you're boasting in your liberty in so much that you're causing other people to stumble because of your boasting, then your boasting is evil. If you know that an idol is nothing in this world and that you're free to eat meat sacrificed unto an idol, that doesn't mean that you're free to do so in the presence of other people who might not have the same understanding that you have. But take heed, verse 9, but take heed, watch out, be careful, beware, take heed, watch yourself, think about what you do before you do it. Remember that you bear the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and it's not all about you. It's about Jesus Christ. Okay, when we were in the world, our motto was, hey, it's all about me. Well, when we come to Jesus Christ, we must decrease so that he may increase. It's not all about you. It's not all about me. It's about Jesus Christ. Whatsoever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks unto God and the Father by him. But take heed lest by any means this liberty of yours become a stumbling block to them that are weak. You see, you have freedom, great. Enjoy your freedom, but don't ever, ever use it as a stumbling block to those around you. Don't ever, ever let it become a stumbling block to those around you. Be careful how you use it. Verse 10, for if any man see thee which hast knowledge, okay, you have knowledge, that's wonderful. Okay, you know that an idol is nothing in this world. That's great. You know, everybody knows that. Well, I shouldn't say everybody, because some people don't, according to this passage of Scripture. But in the Church of Jesus Christ, those of us who have matured in Jesus Christ, we all know this. Okay, it's basic. It's basic knowledge to those of us who are in Jesus Christ and who have matured to the point where we're rooted and grounded in the doctrine of Christ. For if any man see thee which has knowledge, sit at meat in the idol's temple, shall not the conscience of him which is weak be emboldened to eat those things which are offered to idols? Right? See, if you're a Christian, you know that if you go into the temple of a false god and eat meat that was sacrificed unto an idol, you know that that meat's not going to defile you. But should you really do that? Is that really a smart thing for you to do? Because it's not all about you, my friend. My brother, it's not all about you. What you do is seen by the people around you. And so you have the responsibility to abstain from all appearance of evil, which means that you're not just free to do whatever you want. You are a bondservant of the Lord Jesus Christ, and you have to make sure that all the things that you do and say are not going to offend or cause people to stumble. Okay, when I say offend, I'm not talking about hurting people's feelings, because when you speak the word of God, you're going to hurt people's feelings. I'm talking about causing people to stumble. And if your little brothers, or even if, you know, people are pagans, and you're supposed to be a witness of the Lord Jesus Christ, you walk into an idol's temple to eat some meat that was sacrificed unto idols, knowing that the idol is nothing, and that the meat that you're about to eat is just the same as any other piece of meat, is that something that you should do? Is that something that is profitable to others for you to do, just because you know you can? That is a selfish act. It is a sinful act, because it is going to cause others to stumble. You see, even though you're free to eat that piece of meat because that piece of meat cannot defile you, you are not free by the Lord Jesus Christ to walk into that temple in front of other people and do so, because you're going to wound their weak conscience. You're going to teach them error by your action. You see? You know, when I was a little kid, the first time that a curse word came out of my mouth, my mother looked at me and she said, where did you learn how to talk like that? What do you think my answer was? From you? You know, if you're a Christian, you're like the parent, and the people around you are like the little children. And a little child looks at his parent and learns from his parent. They look at everything you do. Little children look at everything you do. They listen to everything you say. And so whatever you do or say in front of them, that's what they're going to do. And when you're a Christian, you have to understand that people all around you are learning about Jesus Christ by the things that you do and say while you're in their presence. You know, it's been said that you are the only Bible that the world will ever read. And so you and I have a great responsibility to, as I said, abstain from all appearance of evil, which means that even though we have the freedom and the authority to do pretty much whatever we want to do, as long as it's not a sin, okay, we can do whatever we want to do. We don't have to keep Sabbath days. We don't have to bring an animal to the temple to have it sacrificed. We don't have to, you know, wear certain kinds of clothes or abstain from wearing cotton with polyester or whatever it is. I forget the two different kinds of fabrics that God mentioned, cotton and it wasn't polyester, of course, but it was linen, woolen and linen. You know, we don't have to abstain from doing that. We don't have to, you know, do the things that God commanded under the law, which are fulfilled in Jesus Christ. But at the same time, having this freedom, we don't flaunt that freedom in front of others to cause them to stumble. We have to remember, just like Paul said, to the Jews I become as a Jew, to the Gentiles I become as a Gentile, to the weak I become as weak, that I become all things that I might gain all men for Jesus Christ. You see, Paul lived his life that way, and so ought we to live our lives that way. Even as he said in Philippians, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. You see, Jesus Christ came into the world, the King of kings, Lord of lords, and he said, the Son of Man has come into the world not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give his life a ransom for many. Jesus Christ washed his disciples' feet. Peter knew who he was, and he said, Lord, thou shalt never wash my feet. And Jesus said, if I wash thee not, thou hast no part with me. You see, whosoever will be greatest among you, let him become your servant. And so those of us who are in Jesus Christ, even though we have knowledge, knowledge puffeth up, but charity edifieth. Okay, people are not impressed by your knowledge. They're impressed by your love. They're impressed by what you do, not by what you know. You see, you may be impressed by what you know, but other people are not, and God is not. But people will be impressed by what you do. That's how people are impressed. And so let's continue again in verse 10. For if any man see thee which has knowledge sit at meat in the idol's temple, shall not the conscience of him which is weak be emboldened to eat those things which are offered to idols? And through thy knowledge shall the weak brother perish for whom Christ died? Wait a minute, did Paul just say perish? Yes, he did. He's an apostle of Jesus Christ. Doesn't he know that once saved, always saved? No, of course he doesn't know that, because there is no such thing. Okay? The wages of sin is death. And whosoever knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. And even though there is no power in an idol to defile a man's conscience, if the man believes that there is power in the idol, and he eats the meat that is sacrificed unto the idol, then he's committing a sin. Do you understand this? Even though it is not a sin to eat meat that is sacrificed unto an idol, if you sacrifice a piece of meat unto an idol and then you offer it to me and I eat it and I give thanks over it in the name of Jesus Christ, I haven't sinned in the act of eating that meat. But if I do it in front of someone else and cause them to eat that same meat when in their conscience they don't feel right about it, then I have sinned. Then I have sinned. And through thy knowledge shall the weak brother perish for whom Christ died. But when ye sin so against the brethren, okay, when ye sin so against the brethren, he didn't say when ye sin so against God, and I'm not saying it's not a sin against God, but he didn't say that. He said, but when ye sin so against the brethren, becoming a stumbling block to your own brethren because of your own pride and selfishness. But when ye sin so against the brethren and wound their weak conscience, ye sin against Christ. Why are you sinning against Christ? Because you are causing to stumble that which he came to save. You're working contrary to what Jesus Christ came to do. And he said, he that is not with me is against me. Verse 13, Wherefore, if meat make my brother to offend, then the answer is very simple. I will eat no flesh while the world standeth. lest I make my brother to offend. Who is my God? Is my God my belly? Am I going to listen to my belly and do what my belly wants? Or is my God the Lord Jesus Christ, who came in the flesh and laid down the precious life to save sinners? Yes, that's who my God is. And to me, it doesn't matter if I eat any meat the rest of the days of my life. If it's going to make my brother to offend, then I won't eat it. Period. End of story. No big deal. Okay? To me, it's not a great thing that I should not eat meat if it's going to cause my brother to offend. Period. That's what love is all about. You see, that's why Paul said, knowledge puffeth up, but charity edifieth. Okay, the fact that I know that I can eat a piece of meat sacrificed unto an idol and it's not going to defile me is common knowledge to those of us who are in Jesus Christ, rooted and grounded in the doctrine of Christ. That's common knowledge to us. You see? But if we do that in front of someone to whom it is not common knowledge and embolden them to do something that's going to violate their conscience, then we are causing them to sin. And that's a very real sin for them. And it will cause them to perish. Is that walking in love? Causing your brother to perish by boasting yourself in your own puffed upness or your own knowledge instead of walking in love? This is what Paul was teaching in this chapter, and he's not done yet. Chapters 8, 9, and 10 are all about this particular issue. And so we'll pick this up again, as we continue in the 9th chapter of 1 Corinthians, which I hope in the Lord Jesus Christ will happen soon. I hope this word has been a blessing to you. It has been to me. Let's continue as soon as we can in the 9th chapter of 1 Corinthians. And may these things be a blessing to you as you continue to meditate upon them and seek God in his word. In Jesus' name, amen.